Number one, recognize the necessity for unity and group operation. Do you understand that if we can work together as a group in unity, we will be more successful, more powerful, more able to do the things that as individuals working by ourselves, we have never been able to do. Two, pool your resources physically as well as financially. Stop wanton criticism of everything that is black owned and operated. Four, keep in mind that jealousy destroys from within. Fifth, observe the operations of the white man. He is successful. He makes no excuses for his failures. He works hard in a collective manner. You do the same. Now, these are things that we must do. Let's go on. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad asked us to commit to save 5 cents a day. What? What? Yes, he said if we can save just 5 cents a day from our wages, 25 cents a week, for 52 weeks in the year, that would mean we would put aside $13 a year that we could save in a national savings treasury. At that time that he wrote this, we numbered 22 million people and approximately 5 million were wage earners. Well, if 5 million wage earners save $13 a year, this would mean 65 million saved out of our wages in 1 year at the rate of 25 cents per week. It would be painless. Now wait, we're just getting started. Now look, today, brothers and sisters, don't you think we can do better than what we were asked to do 48 years ago? According to government statistics, there are a little over 16 million blacks employed at some level. Well, look what happens if we raise the economic bar and contribute the same nickel a day. But we do it 7 days a week with the working force of 16 million. Look at this. 7 days times one nickel a day, 35 cents a week. Do you have it? Isn't that painless? You know you don't like pain. Look at this. 52 weeks in a year, so that amounts to $18.20 per year. And if everybody in this room, everybody listening by television, everybody under the sound of my voice gave $18.20 a year, multiply that by 16 million in the working force. Now we got $291,200,000 in just 1 year. $291 million. Look at the power of pennies, nickels, and dimes if all of us did this. Can you see the picture? Look, we want to do exactly as Isaiah the prophet said, they will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Don't we live in cities? Are the places where we live ruined? Are there many abandoned buildings where we live? Do you own them? You walk by them. You smoke reefers and crack in them. If this resembles any person living or dead, it's not a coincidence. Now look, look, look. That's just 291. Nearly $300 million. Pennies. Pennies. Now I'm going to show you more that we can do with the help of God. I just want you to see the picture. Because once you see the picture, it's done. Now watch this. Isaiah 58 and 12 says that they will be the restorer of streets to dwell in. Look at the streets where we dwell. See, if we started saving money, simple little pennies, we'll show you more of what we can do. And look at this. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says, and to do this, we start with land. 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 The Honorable Elijah Muhammad wrote, the farm is the engine of our national life. Look at the disrespect you have for farmers. Oh, that he's a farmer. Ain't nothing to him. He's a farmer. I beg your pardon. Doctor, you in the house? Lawyer, you in the house? Teacher, you in the house? Preacher, you in the house? Tell me something. If you don't eat well, how long will you practice law? If you don't eat well, you become the patient, doctor. So don't look down on a farmer. Look up to a farmer, because today it will be us farming our own land, producing our own food that will save our lives. Everywhere I have traveled, where we live, black people are not producing food to feed our populations in Africa, in the Caribbean, in Central and South America. Why is that? Why are we buying food in the Caribbean from America, from Australia, from England, from Europe, from France? Why are you doing this when the land under your foot is rich? It hurts me to travel and see us so dependent on others for the basic necessities of life, when the richness of our land is there to produce all that we need and then some. America is for sale, but we are not owning it. We help build this. Our sweat and blood was used to protect it. Shouldn't we be co-owners of it? See, you gotta think like that now.
That's right.
I don't wanna walk streets that we don't own. Everybody can look at their community and say, this is ours. you're the only people that has a community that's owned by things and people that live outside of our community. This shows that there's something wrong with us mentally. Now, since our slave master's children put their faces on the dollar, I think Jackson is on a $20 bill, not Jesse. Since you call the $100 bill Benjamin, that ain't your Benjamin. That's their Benjamin. But like, if they like their face so much, yes, let's collect as many of their faces as we can. Mr. Charlie, look, see your face on the dollars. Mr. Charlie, what we want is all the land that's in the Delta. We want to start in Arkansas, same way they started, buying the land, working the hell out of us, picking the cotton to make America rich and strong. Let's go back over that road. Take their faces, give it back to them. We don't want more fiat money, we want land. Then we can buy the tools that will make us productive on the land, from which will spring all kinds of businesses that inspire entrepreneurs. Not people that are begging somebody else for a job, but you're creating jobs. Then we can grow into a solid economic foundation for us. But without the land, we have no basis for real capital development. Plus, we are an international people. Our brothers and sisters are all over the world, desirous of doing business with us. But if we are not producing anything, we can't enter into trade and commerce with the nations of the earth. As the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wrote in Message to a Black Man, quote, as a people, we must become producers and not remain consumers and employees. We must be able to extract raw materials from the earth and manufacture them into something useful for ourselves. This would create jobs and production. We must remember that without land, there is no production, and the surplus of what we produce, we would sell. This would help develop a field of commerce and trade, as other free and independent people whose population is less than that of ours, so-called Negroes, who are in America dependent. The future's in our hands. You don't have to beat up on other people. You just gotta do right by yourself. Now look, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I was with him one day. He said, brother, I want you to think for the whole and speak for the whole. He didn't want me to speak just for the little nation of Islam. He wanted me to speak for all black people, not only in America, but all over the earth. Think for the whole and speak for the whole. Speak for the whole. Watch this. He said, here's the way I want you to think. If we have 30 million people eating a slice of bread per meal, that's 90 million slices of bread per day. 630 million slices of bread per week. 37,760,000,000 slices of bread per year. How much land must we have under wheat cultivation to give our people their daily bread? Then he said, move on to milk. How much land must we have? How many cows must we own? How much grazing land must we have to give our people a glass of milk with every meal? And I'm not talking about this poisoned milk. I'm talking about real milk that the Quran teaches us from between the blood and the dung, a pure drink. But you can't get that kind of milk from today's cows. You gotta love your cows. How do you show that you love the cow? Now, if you like to eat steak once a week, can't eat it every day. What? But you gotta have grazing land for all your cows. For all your steers. How many sheep must we have, and how much grazing land must we have to give our people a lamb chop? I didn't say pork chop. Lamb chops. Look, would you like a wool coat? See, the sheep is there. Take care of it. It give you its wool. Ain't got to rob nobody. The sheep will lay down, shear it. Take the wool. Make it into a garment. See, you got to own the means of production. Then all your businesses will spring up. All right, let's go on. You getting the picture? How much land must we have to give our people a requirement of spinach or broccoli or carrots, cauliflower, onions, garlic, string beans? All the things that help us to feed ourselves come from the land. We're at 46 million people. How much land must we have? We've got to know just what it takes to feed an entire people. That means we are independent. We've taken our stomach away from our enemies. How much clay land must we have in order to make bricks to start building houses? How much forest land must we have to cut down the trees and make wood to build homes? We are 46 million people, and when you add to that 52 million of our Latino brothers, then you have 224 million Caucasians. The point is, in order to build a nation, he had to give our people a vision of what it's going to take. And we have to have land, and there is no compromising this. So from the farmland, you set up a food industry that deals with the proper way of raising and slaughtering the creatures of God that you intend to eat. You don't run around at a chicken with an axe in your hand. The poor chicken's scared to death. When you get scared, you release hormones that give you the power of fight or flight. Well, the chicken is running. because you're running after it with an axe in your hand. And when you finally get the chicken and hit it, boom, you gotta hit it twice. Then when you eat, the meat is tough, because you're eating the milk of fear. No wonder you scratch when you don't itch. No wonder you shaking in front of your enemy. You gotta eat food that you know how to kill what God has given you authority over. You kill it in the name of God. You kill it in peace. You slaughter it so quick it don't even know it's dead. Then that steak can fall apart in your mouth if you know how to cook. Good organic food that is never genetically modified, that are free of hormones and chemicals and other impurities. You should eat the best that there is, and that can only come from farmers who know, love, and respect the value of the earth. You never have to go to the drugstore or the health food store again if we grow the food properly. Now listen, wait. That's why we gotta own land. That's why the land that we get, we have to purify that land.
That's right.
From all the poisons and chemicals that the former landowner put in it. And that can be done. The science of how to do it is with us. Now look, Hippocrates said, let food be your medicine, and let medicine be your food. Once you know what to do with that kitchen, you stay away from clinics and hospitals, and you hold on the undertaker. Those who are in the undertaking business, they're making money today because of the madness that's going on in our communities. You have health insurance, but we insured our health. I mean, when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was here, we didn't have no health insurance. But we thought Muslims didn't die because we never saw a lot of funerals in the nation. One man could go throughout the whole country burying our dead. Our health insurance was how to eat to live by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. This does not mean that sometime an accident would take place and you need your hospital, you need your doctor. But my mother knew what to do in that bush. What? Our southern folk had knowledge. And white folk would tell you, well, these are witch doctors. Well, you know which doctor we gonna choose. The one that knows the science of food is the right doctor in your life. All right, let's move on. Remember our brother George Washington Carver, who took a peanut and studied it, took a yam and studied it, and came up with 100 different products from going into the peanut? See, that's the skill that you already have inside you if you had land to look at, to work the land. Mm-hmm. So when you don't own any earth, when you don't have any earth that you can call your home, you're at the mercy of those who have it all, and those that have it all don't like you. And those that have it all want to get rid of us and the best way to do it is to feed us. Animal husbandry, the proper raising of animals, not just for their wool or their hide, but for the milk and the meat. So we grow and raise our own food, set it up for food industry. Then there's the proper packaging of these products from what we slaughtered to be sold in our supermarkets. Now you have food processing, canneries, packers and wholesalers of poultry, eggs, lamb and beef. So once these things are processed properly, they come to retail outlets, our supermarkets, restaurants, bakeries across the country. We're just not doing anything to help ourselves. We could have a strict, what are we doing? What's the number one supermarket chain? What is it? Well, you could put Walmart out of business. At least in our community, if you were the grower of the food, watch, when we grow organic food, Walmart sends their people to buy your food. But suppose we had the supermarket. So you thought it suddenly the things you see got the then in the Bible, Quran, it talks about all the living things that are in the sea that are available to us. There are pearls in the sea, the Quran says. There are riches in the sea. There's good food. So we spring from the land into the fishing industry. Put your ships out on the sea to fish for ourselves. See, there's no end to what we can do if we start putting them nickels, pennies, dollars together. Then we'll need cold storage warehouses in various parts of the country to store your produce, your fish, and other perishable goods. With the land, you have cotton, you have wool, and the hides of all the livestock that can be taken to make clothing and shoes. Didn't we pick cotton for the master? I know why we ran off the plantation. We made them rich by picking their crops for nothing or near nothing. We have to ensure that if we put our nickels and dimes and dollars together to buy hundreds of billions of acres of land, we have to take what we buy. That's where the Second Amendment comes in. I said, if we have 100 million acres of land, banking system, we have to protect what is ours from any thief or robber that will try to take it from us. And that's where the Second Amendment comes in for us. No robber come in our land. Farrakhan, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said we shouldn't carry weapons. No, we won't carry. But when we get what is required to build a nation, what the hell kind of nation would we be if we can't protect our own borders, our own airspace, and our own land? We got 400,000 black soldiers fighting somebody else's war. Come on home, black soldiers. Come on and stand with us. We don't believe we should take part in wars which take the lives of humans, especially when we have nothing to gain from it. Unless we have the necessary territory where we have something to fight for. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught me how to negotiate for weapons to defend our land.
We don't have to part as enemies.
Sing it together now. Joy, ooh, and pain.
No, no, no.
I like sunshine.
We, the followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, are here to demonstrate our love for our people, our concern for the worsening condition of America and its people. Whether the people of America feel the need to reciprocate or not, I'm here to present a torchlight that is intended to save our lives as well as all of America, if she will only take heed.
All you gangbangers, we know you love to shoot, but you're killing yourself. We want to make you a defender of the territories that your nickels, dimes, and dollars and hours will buy. You are the natural warriors to defend, and the science of war must be taught to us so that we will protect whatever God allows us to buy or to build. The Second Amendment has no relevance to the black community in this sense. You don't have legal weapons. All your weapons are illegal, and you're using them like a savage people would use them. We respect the Second Amendment. We know that it had value to keep a new government from slipping back into tyranny. And that's why Mr. I think it's Bob Jones or Bill Jones said, if you really want to see Alex Jones, if you really want to see some problems, we'll take you back to 1776 if you try to take away our guns. Now, the militia have their guns trained on the government because they don't like the way their government is functioning. We don't believe we need to part in a negative frame of mind. We've benefited much from being here. Even though we were slaves, we are the best educated black people anywhere to be found on the earth. But now we have to use that education. You know why Chief Malik of the El Rukans is in jail? Not because he's a dope slinger. It's because he knew the art of organizing young black people. You know why Barksdale is dead? Because he had the art of organizing young black people. You know why Geronimo Pratt had to leave America and died in Africa? Because Geronimo had military science, and he wanted to share that with young black people, and they put him in prison. What they don't want is an organized black community, and they do not want leaders that organize young black men. I received a letter from Chief Malik, and I want Chief Malik to know that we are honored to receive your letter, brother. Thank you for your concern for the black community. I know that you're not going to spend your life behind bars.
because there's too much work for strong black men to do. And so we're on the precipice of something new and better. So don't become frustrated. We will have what we desire. Either they'll help us to get it, or God Himself will give it to us.
Thank you for your love.
On our own merit.
Thank you, baby.
You are